to you, model parameters, and all of this is passed into the pipeline, okay, for 1000 iterations, as you can see in this case, okay. And then there is something called a learning rate by degrees. So a total learning rate will start from probably say 0.01 or some other value which is already predefined, and a total decay will happen in terms of what we are passing as parameter. For example, the learning rate might be 0.01 for the first iteration. After it made some mistake, I decrease that learning rate by 1e-3. 1e-3 basically means some value which will be very small, say 0.004. I'll subtract that from my learning rate. So for beginners, what is learning rate? Learning rate is similar to what how you learn for your exams, right? So you first, for example, you start learning by practicing mathematics questions once, then you again practice it twice. Then when you are doing it thrice, you perfect it, right? So in how many hours you are able to perfect it? That is basically how you actually proceed to understand the idea of a learning rate. Similarly, for a machine learning point of view, a learning rate is the amount or the measure through which a model tries to learn the features of our input data in order to correctly predict the target variable. Ideally, a learning rate should be low, and that is also a very important hyperparameter which needs to be tuned. So for that, we do something called grid search. What grid search basically does, it divides the entire data into different grids, small grids, and it tries to experiment with different hyperparameter values. For example, if I start for the first iteration out of 1000 iteration, it will have a different learning rate for the first set of data. It will have a different learning rate for the second set of data, and so on and so forth. How many different sets it will be making? That I'll be passing exclusively through pre-dispatch by specifying the number of jobs which I'll be passing. In this case, when you are saying the number of jobs is -1 and 2 into -1, which is -2, by minus I means after how many jobs, after how many mistakes rather, my model should decrease the learning rate. So -2 means if there are 2 mistakes made by my model, okay, then I will decrease the learning rate, otherwise I'll keep on proceeding. So fit function obviously fits it, and each iteration, as you can see, this cell which is having a very clear output shot right now is takes a very lot of time to actually come. Okay, for me it take on my local PC it took around, say it's written 6 minutes. So, and sometimes if your data is very huge, this is a very small data set, if it's very huge it might take an hour also, for example if you are classifying some images and all. So now we try to evaluate the best parameters, as some user also asked, which are the best parameters. So grid eval returns which are the best parameters from the predefined function, which I built in function which I made above, and it tells the best score so far is 95, and the best parameter is on the learning rate of 0.001 with the loss of log and not hinge, and the model penalty is L1. So grid search really saved me the time of manually doing this idea of 6 minutes again and again. Now this might seem little stupid in case of 6 minutes, but now imagine when you are working in a company, you have 3 million data, this becomes and increases to a very good sufficient amount of time, which is appreciable. That is the main crux of using grid search over here. And then you evaluate your scores. So you can see that the recall is 99, the F1 is 1.0. But at the same time, the F1 for identifying the other transaction is low, and the total accuracy which you see is 99% only. Okay. So now this isn't a very, very good model. It is definitely good, but as you can see from the confusion matrix, there are different. Now, how do I evaluate whether a model is good or not is something very important. So for that, I have written actually a very good blog about it. And you can go through this blog later on so that you can exactly understand how exactly a confusion matrix works like. In a very brief, I'll explain how a confusion matrix works. Better idea to get to the main thing. So just look over here. A confusion matrix in this case of credit card fraud detection, as you can see, win-win situation means that we have classified an actual correct legitimate transaction as an actual correct legitimate transaction. That means actually it was a legitimate And our model also predicted that yes, it's legitimate. So that's a win. Now, actual legitimate means that it is in reality not a fraud transaction, and therefore we predict it as not a fraud transaction. At the same time, if there is actually a fraud transaction with a class label of 1, we predict that as a fraud transaction. That's also a win-win case. And the two error case which I have labeled as fails are one, when it's actually correct but we predicted as fraud, and the other, when it's actually fraud but we predicted it as correct. Now, from a very data science use case view, these are the two problems, right, which are highlighted. So the first one is, which is actually a correct transaction, but my model says it's a fraud transaction. Okay, so this is a problem to the bank, as the client may feel irritated, and maybe after a series of clarification, the customer will be proved innocent also. This might lead to some wastage of resources since the customer is genuine and I predicted him as fraud. This is a little problematic, but doesn't really incur much of a loss to me. But now imagine the other error which we are seeing. Okay, it's actually a fraud and we projected a legitimate, this one which I'm pointing on. So this becomes a huge problem because the fraud transaction is undetected and the client, whose money goes away, might actually file a legal case against the bank for the huge amount of loss. So that becomes even more problematic for the bank. So our idea when we are making a model is to try to get a balance between these two. But we need to be sure that there might, our model might not be fully accurate and might have some problems which are like this. That means actually a correct transaction, but we predicted that no, that transaction is fraud. That is acceptable to a certain degree. But the most unacceptable part is the last one, which is actually a fraud and I'm predicting is correct. This becomes a very huge problem, right? So this is how we measure what exactly we need to do as a data scientist and how we actually need to measure our model's accuracy, or we need to evaluate rather and select the correct evaluation metric for our entire model. So you can go through this blog. It talks about credit card fraud detection only and gives you a very good detail about it and how exactly what are exactly going about it. But I hope you got a general idea of what I'm trying to say, right? Any doubts regarding this? Okay, the question is, can we operate on a subset of data to save time? Yes, that's what sampling is, right? Sampling of data, which I already mentioned, stratify sampling in the splitting of data itself. Where did it go? Where am I splitting the data? Yeah. So when you're sampling the data itself, over there only you are making different subsets of data. Even in grid search, you are making subsets of data, right? And that's the reason you are able to get a better idea of the entire population. So that is also something covered in statistics, right? When we are taking a small subset of our entire set of features and trying to predict or make a model which is suitable for that entire set of features. That entire set of features is something called population. And the set of subset of features of data which we took is called a sample. So that comes when you go in depth of statistics behind it. And of course, machine learning is all about mathematics. So just like that, we also compared our accuracies with random forest classification. How it works, it takes different decision trees, combines it to make a forest and take different forests to combine in order to minimize correlation between data. The good thing about this classifier, which I like, is that in random forest classifiers, we really need to just simply put the data inside. You don't need to worry about handling correlations because it handles by itself. But in our case, we already handled the correlations pretty well because there were hardly any correlations in the data when I showed the heat map. And again, I evaluated this also. So that is having a very good appreciable accuracy, as you can say, 99.95. But is it good enough or not? We actually need to see through our F1 score, which is pretty decent. F1 score is a better indicative of it, which is 87%. The main issue is whether you are having a correct confusion matrix out of it for which you can plot it, which I already explained. Then we tried logistic regression on it with the same pipeline, and we got a very poor F1 score, but a very high accuracy, as you can see. So that means the data is not at all linear, and logistic regression generally works with linear data. How exactly logistic regression works is something that I'll try to tell in a different scenario, but in a very short, इसको हम लोग हिंदी में संक्षिप्त बोलते हैं, it tries to construct a decision boundary between the classes which are specified, in this case the fraud transactions and the not fraud transactions, and then try to separate them equally so that the not fraud transactions are completely lying towards one set of the entire boundary and the other is completely lying towards the other set of the boundary. So that's how this works. And lastly, we tried the k-neighbors, nearest neighbor classifier also. A k-nearest neighbor means that it will take one data point, search its nearest neighbors, okay? That nearest number of nearest neighbors will be specified by you as a hyperparameter, as you can see. Okay, sorry, I'm sharing the code again. I just switched the tab, sorry. So I'll just go through again, random forest classifier, which I talked about, okay? It doesn't have a very good score. It has a good score. LR doesn't have a very good score, as you can see. Okay, similarly, K nearest neighbor classifier, this one has a pretty nice score compared to others. And the best part about grid search is it returned to me that the nearest number of neighbors which is should be there should be 2. And I had passed it at 5 if you've seen. Okay. So in this way, grid search works really well. And I got to know my accuracy as well as my F1 score nicely, okay. So in this case, K nearest neighbors turned out to be a very good classifier in terms of accuracy. Again, it's not the best classifier. The best will be random forest, but in terms of accuracy, since it was reported according to that, we really need to take a K nearest neighbors compared to others, while we also use SMOTE to overcome overfitting, okay. So in short, a summary of our entire analysis was that almost all fraud transactions occur below 2500 rupees or dollars, and almost all fraud transactions are equitably distributed throughout time with no clear relationship between any of those frauds, and the number of fraud transactions are very compared to legitimate transaction. It can be fairly balanced using SMOTE, which we already showed to you over here that it really balanced it out using SMOTE. Okay, so this is how you go about doing a crisp DM approach. And this was half of the DM approach. After that, as I already mentioned in the chat also, the approach after modeling and evaluation, there is something called a last step called deployment. So in deployment, different companies make use of different stuff. For hackathons and all, definitely I would recommend you to make use of Flask or make Android apps and stuff. For actual deployment, we make use of SageMaker, AWS, and you know, heavy data warehouses where we can constantly record data at the same time, and so that we can operate it. Then there is something called real-time analytics also, which we make use of Scala and Spark, where you, for example, in Netflix, when you click something, the real-time analytics starts showing by popping you different recommendations. So that is then something using Apache Spark and not using Python and all this. So I hope I was pretty clear about it. Any doubts regarding it, you can definitely go through my